On this episode of China Unscripted, the Chinese Communist Party knows how the U.S. thinks. They're going to use that to defeat the U.S. in battle. Welcome to China Unscripted. I'm Chris Chappell.
I'm Shelley Zhang.
And I'm Matt Ganesda.
Joining us today is Michael Listner. He's the founder of Space Law and Policy Solutions. His company consults with governments and policymakers on issues related to outer space security. Michael, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
So, you know, China's military, often in the West, we kind of think of it like people kind of dismiss it as, you know, a paper tiger or whatnot. But it's actually a very ambitious organization and has a lot of interest in space. Whereas in the U.S., you know, NASA is supposedly more of a civilian organization. We got the Chinese military actively looking into space. And I know you're interested in space law. What's going on?
What's going on? Definitely a lot. When we talk about China, the People's Republic of China, to be specific, because there is that difference with this ongoing political thing about China, about Taiwan and its autonomy and the People's Republic of China. That's another fracas for another conversation. But fundamentally, when you talk about China, we're talking about not only a different country, but a different culture and how they view things. When we think of China, PRC in particular, we're talking about thousands of years of history, whereas, you know, here in the West, we measure it, well, for lucky, in hundreds of years or maybe close to 1,000 years in the case of Europe. It's definitely a unique country. They, like I said, different culture, different thoughts on things. But when we think about China in terms of space, they understand they have both a military and political interest, but they also have a cultural connection to it. So when we talk about comparing, say, the U.S. to China, there really, or the PRC, there is no comparison, because they look at the world differently in terms of geopolitics, in terms of culture, in terms of how they view space. So let's talk about NASA. NASA is a civilian organization that was created by Congress. But I say civilian in that it's non-military, or supposed to be non-military. However, space in the PRC is all under the People's Liberation Army. The PLA has its tentacles in everything, including space. Now, there is, quote, a non-military organization called the China National Space Administration, CNSA. However, that is basically controlled by the PLA because it deals with rockets. So when we think of PLA, when we think of the PRC and outer space, understand that there is a strong, really very strong military component to it, as opposed to here in the U.S., where we have NASA and the Department of Defense and the intelligence community that are separate entities and have their own activities in outer space as well.
So when we talk about the PRC's space program is essentially run by the PLA, how does that manifest on a practical level? Like, what are they interested in that, for example, NASA may not be doing?
Well, the PLA is interested in space dominance, or, you know, space superiority, what we call space control. In other words, actually being able to not only control their, having the freedom to do their activities, but also denying an adversary the ability to perform their activities. NASA, on the other hand, its charter is basically dealing with exploration, technology development, things of that sort, and things involving the Earth's biosphere as well. PLA, they're really not interested in that. They're basically interested in military objectives, national security uses of outer space, and how to further China's national interests not only in outer space, but on the moon and other celestial bodies.
So NASA is playing Star Trek and China is playing Star Wars.
Well, I guess you could put it that way. If you want to use movie acronyms, that's probably an accurate statement.
Well, and I do. But so you talk about it's being controlled by the People's Liberation Army, but China and Russia, they came up with something called the Treaty on the Prevention of Placement of Weapons in Outer Space. So clearly, you know, we can trust China and Russia.
Because they don't want weapons in outer space.
Yeah. They obviously, they don't actually have military.
Because they want to prevent.
Yeah, they want to prevent. The treaty is called the Prevention.
Well, again, this goes. They first proposed that treaty, I believe it was in 2008. They amended that treaty in 2014. We're going to shift into space weapons. So a little bit of a history is involved here to understand the geopolitics and diplomacy of space weapons. During the initial formation of the Outer Space Treaty, the two big players were the Soviet Union and the United States. And when they were negotiating this treaty, this Outer Space Treaty, there's this term called peaceful purposes that you find in the treaty. Well, when the speaker negotiated, the Soviet Union basically said they wanted to use this term called no militarization of outer space. And you hear that a lot nowadays, and from NGOs, from the Russians, from the China, from the PRC, no militarization. Now, there was back and forth, and finally the US prevailed and we got peaceful purposes in the Outer Space Treaty itself. So after the treaty was passed, there was this big thing about anti-satellite weapons, with the Soviet Union basically brandishing this idea of, you know, we got to have this ban on ASATs, on space weapons, without even defining what a space weapon was. After the Reagan administration, post-SDI, the Strategic Defense Initiative, when missile defense really became prominent, the focus of space weapons changed to missile defense. Now, what I want listeners to understand here is that when we talk about space weapons, we're really talking about missile defense. As much as they don't downplay it, Both the Russian Federation and the Chinese are very concerned about missile defense. And part of the idea of missile defense is to deploy mid-course systems in orbit. And that's where the whole idea of space weapons comes about. If we can diplomatically work the U.S. into a box where we can get them to ban space weapons, we can basically bring in all these other assets that would actually be used for mid-course defense. Like Brilliant Pebbles was one thing that was very prominent in the SDI architecture, and it was actually technically feasible at the time, and still technically feasible. Something like that would classify as a space weapon.
All right. So I have a question about this missile defense. So when I think of missiles, I think of basically essentially rockets that are launched either from the ground or from a ship or something similar. And they might go up quite high, like if it's an ICBM, but they're hitting a ground target, right? So, and then you have, what is this mid-course space thing? Like how does that interact with a missile?
Well, when an ICBM launches, you have the boost phase, which gets it out of the atmosphere. And then it kicks in, there's another stage that brings it up into what is considered space. Doesn't put it into orbit, but it brings it into space and starts honing in on its target. At that point, it would actually release a warhead or warheads to hone in their target. At that point, this mid-course system would be there to actually interdict those warheads as they were going into, just before they entered what we call a terminal phase. Now, once they enter terminal phase, there's another layer of defense, which you see with like the Aegis system, ground-based systems that would intercept those. But the mid-course would basically be something like Brilliant Pebbles, an energy weapon that would actually go in and intercept warheads before they had a chance to re-enter the atmosphere.
So currently, are there any of these systems?
Not that we know of. None that have been publicly disclosed. And I say that because there is a very black world out there of special access projects, and we really don't know what they're doing. Another issue with space, the PPWT, understand, is a diplomatic weapon. It's what I call a lawfare weapon. It's there to create chaos and make the U.S. and its allies look bad. We're saying no, we're not going to sign on to this. So it's about making them look bad.
We're talking about the treaty that Russia and China proposed, like
the PPWT. That's the short version.
Okay, so basically, what you're saying is that they either the U.S. agrees or the U.S. refuses, and then it makes the U.S. look bad. But if the U.S. agrees, then there's consequence too, right?
Right. We know there's consequence. We know it's a bad deal. And one of the big problems with it is the definition of space weapons, and I don't have it right here in the PPWT, doesn't cover ground-launched missiles. So that's a big problem. I mean, if you're going to exclude those, you still have a weapon, an ASAT weapon you could launch from the ground. In fact, these are very common. The PRC demonstrated one back in 2007. Back in 1982, I think it was, the U.S. demonstrated an air-launched version of an ASAT weapon.
So
we demonstrated. Go ahead.
Sorry, an ASAT weapon is what, like anti-satellite weapon?
Anti-satellite.
Yeah. So,
an anti-satellite weapon is any. I can't define it, but any instrumentality that's used to basically destroy or disable a satellite. This has been there are hard kill, there's soft kill. Hard kill being I run right into it and actually shatter it. Soft kill, I use cyberspace to hack the satellite, or I use lasers to blind it or disable it. There are different layers to what an ASAT weapon is. In other words, it's hard to define a space weapon because there are so many different classifications, and anything could be a space weapon depending on how you use it.
Well, I was going
to
say, this sounds like it's a problem of definitions, like with, you know, assault weapons. Like, there's really no actual definition of what it means, so it can mean anything.
Well, it is. We have this term called dual-use technologies, and and most outer space instrumentalities can be dual-use. For example, we have a ballistic missile defense system that's actually staged aboard cruisers and destroyers that can use their missiles to intercept incoming warheads. However, during a program called Operation Burnt Frost back in the 2000s during the Bush administration, we had an intelligence gathering satellite that just failed almost immediately until it went into orbit, and it was going to come down. There was a big concern about fuel in the tank might actually spread and contaminate and cause damage. So basically, the U.S. decided we're going to use an ancillary capability of our ballistic missile defense to intercept this satellite before it reenters the atmosphere. And they did, and it was very successful. They intercepted it on the first try with a missile launched off from an Aegis destroyer. It was extremely, I think, either destroyer or cruiser, I can't remember. But it was very successful. And all of a sudden, everybody, the Russians, the PRC, everybody just came out, oh my God, they just made an aggressive move. They just demonstrated a space weapon, and all hell broke loose. I mean, this is an uncensored podcast, so that's basically what happened. But again, missile defense we demonstrated that missile defense has an ancillary capability for anti-satellite weapons. The Russians did it back in 2021. The Indians demonstrated back in 2019. And so the capability is out there. But you can't ban that weapon. It's hard to ban that weapon because its primary purpose or primary function is for missile defense. Hence, getting back to the whole what I call lawfare action against space weapons, they're trying to defeat missile defense, not space weapons.
Well, let me give an example of that.
What you're saying is essentially, like, under this treaty, the prevention, which sounds good, the Treaty on the Prevention of Placements of Weapons in Outer Space, what the Russia and China would be able to do is say, well, you know, something that is supposed to defend you from missiles launched from the ground and also hitting the ground could be considered a space weapon, but something that is launched from the ground in order to hit a satellite could not be a space weapon.
Pretty much, but the whole point is the definition is the idea of a space weapon. I've had conversations with people trying to define it. It's indefinable. You really cannot define it. I'm going to bring in a little bit of law on another side, just kind of demonstrate my feelings on this. There was a Supreme Court case many years ago that was dealing with the subject of what constitutes something being obscene. And the justice really and the Supreme Court really wrangled with it. And they said, you know what? We can't define it, but here's our ruling. We can't define it legally, but we'll know it when we see it. So that's kind of been my approach to space weapons. I can't define it, but I'll know it when I see it.
Okay, well, I have a question about...
I do want to talk about this real quick, because it does seem like basically what China and Russia were doing is presenting this treaty that would, if the U.S. agreed to it, it would limit the United States' defensive capabilities. So obviously they weren't going to do that. But then if the U.S. says, no, we're not going to sign this treaty about space weapons, it kind of plays into...
Preventing space weapons.
Well, yeah, as we're recording this, there was just the Tucker Carlson-Putin interview. And one of the big lines of that is Putin basically saying, well, everything is America's fault. America, like Russia tried to make peace, but America, like, so Putin had to invade Ukraine, you guys. It's because of the United States. And this plays right into that line of propaganda that it's always the U.S. that is the aggressor.
Well, it's called lawfare. In other words, using the law international on this case to actually box in your opponent, and at the same time, you have no intention of actually abiding by the rules you're setting. And this is very common, especially with the PRC and the Russians. They come out with these grandiose treaties. We we for lack of a better term, we get suckered into them, and they, when it's convenient, they completely ignore it, saying, yeah, we're not going to do that. And of course, you have NGOs here on the in academia saying, well, you've really got, you know, we signed it, and we made the commitment, we've got to follow it, even though it's going to benefit us, it's going to detriment us strategically.
Because we're a free society, and our government will be held accountable by all these NGOs and people saying, hey, we signed this. But authoritarian regimes like Russia and China, they can do whatever they want.
Exactly.
Let's take something that is in space but seems to be totally civilian, like Elon Musk's Starlink. That's for people getting internet access, right, around the world. But the Ukrainian military is using their access to Starlink to, you know, help them with certain defense capabilities and missile targeting capabilities. So then, according to this treaty, would Starlink be considered a space weapon, and then somehow you could kind of go after that?
Maybe I'll qualify that with a maybe, but again, it's because it's been, because there are other laws that come in, like the law of armed conflict, because this is even though it's a civilian asset, a non-governmental asset, it's still supporting a military action. So that in some cases, the law of armed conflict might actually say, okay, that's a legitimate target.
Right. So in other words, anything in space could be, whether if it's civilian, anything in space could be theoretically used by the military.
Well, look, just look at GPS. GPS was a program developed by the Air Force for global navigation, but it has a military signal and has a civilian signal, and the whole industry has built up around the civilian signal. I mean, everybody uses GPS. The Europeans have a similar system. The PRC has developed a massive system called Beidou as well. But the idea is, the primary purpose for developing GPS was to help military forces navigate, but also to guide munitions. And we see that with GPS-guided bombs, cruise missiles, I believe now use GPS instead of their old TERCOM system. But that has become a weapon in a sense. So you're going to see a lot about this whole thing. You hear a lot about this whole thing about weaponization and militarization of space. Space has been weaponized and militarized for decades, but the Outer Space Treaty doesn't prohibit that.
So you're mentioning that China sees space completely culturally different than the United States. So if the U.S., as you mentioned, essentially what the U.S. is doing is already kind of dual use, civilian military. What is China and the Chinese military doing in space? Is it just like mimicking what the U.S. is doing? Do they have a totally different strategy? What are they using space for? What are their space weapons like?
Again, the PRC, the Communist Central Committee, PRC, basically has these five-year plans. They have five-year plans for many things, including outer space. Every 5 years, they'll issue a white paper, and there's usually a publicly unclassified version of it made available. And that basically sets out their goals, their strategic outlook, the way they see space, what they're planning on doing. And, you know, in broad terms, obviously, for the next 5 years. You got to read between the lines, and you got to look at what happens here on Earth. Now, I, for one, hate comparing outer space to the terrestrial environment. I mean, I hate it, but I do it all the time. So I'm guilty of the thing that I loathe the most. There's a problem that's been going on for over 10 years in the South China Sea, where the Chinese, who are actually a signatory to the UN Treaty on the Law of the Sea, have basically gone out and started claiming sovereign territory and creating these artificial islands in the South China Sea, the Nine Dash Line region. And they're basically asserting sovereignty over there. And one of the things they're using is their culture, basically saying, well, back in our history, thousands of years of history, our people were out here and we are just reclaiming what is rightfully ours. And they're doing the same thing with the Philippines right now. And you know, there's a very, you know, very good chance a conflict could blow up out of that, depending on how they react. Well, they're doing the same thing in outer space. I need to do a little history here to build on this.
Are you going to tell me the Chinese were in space?
Well, I mean, think about it. Thousands of years ago, Chang'e drank an immortality potion and went to the moon.
Okay, but I think that people wouldn't, like, you could make an argument about Qing Dynasty maps or whatever, right? That,
right.
you know, suddenly appear, the claiming.
Not moon fairies.
But, like, nobody's going to be like, oh, well, yeah, your folk legend is going to give you a claim on space.
Hey, Chang'e is also what they named their moon lander.
Yes, their orbital, yeah.
Well, look, you got to understand, it's a gradual thing. It isn't all at once. It's like a drip, 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 drip. The Chinese Central Committee adopted the strategy called the Three Warfares, which is basically using the law, the media, and psychology to achieve political ends without having to use the military. And the whole idea is we're going to use our culture and our ancient claims and these ancient maps to basically build a narrative, a political narrative. And the idea is eventually, gradually, if we use the media, use TikTok, for example, we can convince people that this is actually true. Our claims are valid. This is actually factual. It's a slow strategy, but the culture there isn't like America where we got to have something, we got to try something new every 5 minutes. They think in terms of decades and in some cases centuries. What do we need in, you know, the next half century and the next century? And they build their strategy on there, and they adjust their tactics as they go along. The Chang'e, they have a lander on the back of the moon right now, the Chang'e. And my comment was, you know what the heck are they doing back there? They landed one of their Chang'e landers and it deployed this little rabbit, this little thing called the jade rabbit, which is also in their cultural mythology, on the surface. But after that lander deployed, they did an interesting thing. A flag popped up on their lander, a communist Chinese flag. And I looked at that, and I understood the significance of this. Now, everybody says, well, the Americans did the same thing. No, the Americans didn't do the same thing. After Neil and Buzz landed on the moon and planted the flag, which was actually an afterthought, it was never part of the original mission plan, Congress got really worried because we signed this thing called the Outer Space Treaty just a few years earlier. And one of the things the Outer Space Treaty says is you can't make a sovereign claim. So what did we do during the Age of Discovery when they came to the New World? They'd plant a flag or something else and claimed it in the name of the king or the queen for Spain, Portugal, England, what have you. So really, Congress is worried, what is the significance of this flag? What message are we sending? So in between Apollo 11 and Apollo 12, NASA passed an authorization act, and they put in that a little blurb and basically says the emplacement of the American flag on the moon is not a claim of sovereignty. It's just basically an expression of national pride and achievement. So they basically made sure the planting of the flag was consistent with the Outer Space Treaty. The PRC on the air had raised their national flag on the moon. So what does that mean? Do they have a law? Do they have a law on the book similar to we do, saying it's just a symbol of national pride and achievement, or is it actually a claim of national sovereignty? We don't know. We don't know what their policy is on it, and I'm highly suspicious of it, and I mentioned this to many people. Now, of course, regardless if you tell them about the American law, they keep on going back, well, the Americans did it first, and I've had to remind people, no, it's not the same. So I'm very concerned that what they're doing here in the terrestrial environment in the South China Sea, even, you know, encroaching on India by going out here and making these claims and creating this narrative, they're actually doing the same thing on the moon.
Yeah, it's interesting when you started talking about this idea that they wanted to dominate space and also prevent other countries from being able to do what they want to in space. That immediately brought to mind the South China Sea to me as well, because it's not just about claiming sovereignty over these islands, right? They're trying to keep the Philippines from being able to resupply their, you know, islands that they claim. They're trying to maybe control the global shipping environment in the South China Sea. So that is definitely pretty scary.
Yeah, because the moon is the next step in any country's like space exploration. If China can deny access to the moon.
It isn't just about exploration. It's about utilization. Back in 2015, the U.S. passed a space resource law, which basically says any private citizen who goes to the moon or the asteroid or a comet and harvests, you know, water, ice, regolith, minerals, whatsoever, that becomes, they can take possession of that and sell it. Now, the Russians immediately jumped right on it, hated it, and they keep on being against it. And slowly, it's becoming what we call, what I call customary international law, customary interpretation of the outer space treaty. The Chinese have been really quiet about it, but in a sense they've been kind of accepting about it. And the problem with that is that China talks about its quote commercial space industry, but really they don't have a commercial space industry because any private company in China has government ownership to it. So here's a scenario, and I've actually fleshed this out before to the media. I'm a quote commercial Chinese company. I go to the moon. And I start harvesting mineral materials there. Now, but that's all well and good. However, I got to remember that Chinese company is still really, in a sense, an extension of the Communist Party in China. And basically, they are in a sense extending sovereignty not only over those minerals that they're harvesting, but they're also potentially claiming sovereignty over the actual plot where they are actually harvesting the minerals from. In other words, they're violating the Outer Space Treaty, or in other words, rewriting the Outer Space Treaty. Or better yet, they're invalidating the non-sovereignty principle in the Outer Space Treaty by doing so.
Is that why you think China landed Chang'e 4 on the dark side of the moon? Because they wanted to, because the U.S. hasn't been to that region. Right. So China can say, oh, we're the first to this region. And then maybe 10, 20, 100 years from now, they can say, oh, well, we were the first to this region. So therefore, we claim this part of the moon. They get the whole far side of the moon.
I think it's part of the reason. In other words, you know, national pride and, you know, to promote them, you know, promote the stuff as these great, you know, leaders in outer space. There is a geopolitical aspect to, you know, this, to their space program as well. They want to have other countries to join with them because of their quote technical prowess, et cetera, et cetera. So that's part of it. But however, landing and physically occupying the territory, I believe, is a first step in actually acquiring and validating this whole idea of non-sovereignty in the Outer Space Treaty and start laying claims to it. It's very interesting, but I always say that I've always said to people that the South China Sea, this is a dry run for outer space.
You know, it's really interesting because, like, in the South China Sea, they call it salami slicing, that sort of drip, drip, drip pressure. And you already see that with space because I think a lot of people hear these things and are like, I don't buy this. I don't care. This is all future stuff. And so they don't get pushback. And it's already that drip, drip, drip is beginning. And then...
Or I think there's also this way that it's hard to push back on what looks like space exploration.
Yeah.
Right? Like, there's this whole idea that of space exploration as like, oh, like a noble thing that countries should be doing and participating in. And somehow also the idea that it crosses borders and brings countries together.
It's the end of history.
Like, yeah, because, like, you know, for many years after the Soviet Union fell, like Russia and the US were working together on space stuff, right? Even though they were competing so much before. So then there's the idea that, like, we should all be able to cooperate in space. So then when China starts, like, putting, you know, astronauts in space and, like, doing all this kind of stuff, it becomes hard to be like, wait a minute, what are they doing? You know, like, it becomes difficult to object to things that look like, on the surface, like what NASA does
because
or what other
countries
do.
Because then it comes back to, oh, it's the U.S. being the aggressor and just trying to take over space for themselves.
Exactly. And this whole, I mean, you hear about this whole thing about cooperation. The PRC laments, oh, we got to have more cooperation. In fact, there is a law, an appropriations law called the Wolf Amendment that prevents NASA from cooperating with China. And it's a good thing because fundamentally they want technology. They want access to technology. That's basically cooperation. I look at cooperation as, you know what, it isn't so much... It's a nice political option. You got to understand, what am I really getting out of this? You know, besides warm and fuzzy feelings, and what are they getting out of it? Because they're obviously going to get more than warm and fuzzy feelings out of it.
I don't imagine the Communist Party ever really looks for warm and fuzzy feelings.
Oh. But they have a very good. They project a very good face. Look at social media, TikTok especially. They are very effective in factualizing it. We're talking about getting astronauts back on the moon and why this is important. And it's important for two reasons. One, the ones who get there first and actually start developing get to make the rules. But two, we got to preserve the history as well. We got to say we're back and we're here. And all this history back 50 some odd years ago when we landed human beings on the world, that is valid history. If the PRC gets there and starts developing beforehand, they're in a good position to basically invalidate that history and say it never existed.
Like, in other words, they're going to invalidate the actual moon landing, like say it was, you know, produced in the studio by Stanley Kubrick.
Exactly. They can use social media is very powerful, and they use it very effectively. Like through TikTok, for example, they can basically say, well, all these things, you know, they can say, well, the moon landings were faked, it never happened. And with the generation that's hooked into this, they're likely going to take that as fact. And the PRC could effectively erase history of the moon landings during the Apollo program.
That is actually a very interesting point, because we had someone on recently talking about how after the October 7th attack on Israel, TikTok was pushing out a lot of like very pro-Palestinian content. And then like as the APEC summit came up, it reduced that. So that seems like it's something the Chinese Communist Party was pushing. Like actually, because a new generation of Americans, they don't know anything about this conflict. If most young Americans are getting all their news from this Chinese-controlled platform, that's very dangerous.
It's part of the three warfares. It's the media aspect of the three warfares they're using.
No, I mean, I'm also thinking about like Hollywood movies and The Martian, right? Which is probably one of the biggest space movies to come out in years. And then there's that whole idea that essentially like the Chinese space program is coming in and saving the day.
Wasn't that also a part of Gravity too?
I didn't watch Gravity, so.
Yes, Sandra Bullock got over to the Chinese space station, I believe it was, and took one of their capsules and got back to Earth. And I'll just tell you right now, Mark Watney, no matter what he said, he wasn't really a space pirate legally.
Well, that's good to know. Yeah, you are the expert on space law, so. There we go. He's not a pirate.
What is a space pirate? And how does one become a space pirate if one were interested in such a thing?
There's no legal statute on the book for what constitutes space piracy. There is something for piracy on the high seas, but not for outer space. And given the way the outer space treaty is written, I'm sorry, it may have made Mark Watney feel better about himself, but he wasn't a space pirate legally.
So it's actually impossible to be a space pirate currently.
Well, right now it is until we come up with some rules about it. But that's decades away, so I'm not worried about it.
I'm beginning to plan decades into the future. Now, a big thing that's always talked about whenever we're talking about space weapons is space debris. We know China has been very successful at launching anti-satellite missiles, blowing up its own craft, and creating space debris, which is a very potentially dangerous thing. Can you tell us about why that is such a concern and how China might leverage that?
Well, I'm more concerned about upper stages than I am about ASAT tests.
What's the difference? I'm curious about why.
The difference is upper stages are these big things, and if you don't make sure they're properly defueled and the battery is discharged, the extremes of the environment could make them go boom. And they can make much more debris than a destructive ASAT test. This is it's a very big concern. And the Russian Federation and the PRC are the biggest offenders when it comes to that. Another thing on space debris, last year when they were launching the modules on their Heavenly Palace space station, they were basically using a single stage to orbit this big, large booster that was actually spinning around the Earth uncontrollably, and nobody knew it was going to come down. And they did that about three or four times in order to get all the modules assembled up there. And it was a big concern because they didn't know where they was going to land. And if it landed, if it landed in my backyard and actually it flew over my area a few times, they would have been liable for the damage under international law. Now, it would have been a big fight to get them to admit it and get them to pay up for it, but they would have been liable for it, and not to mention the potential, you know, for injury or death that might have occurred from it. Now, I'm going to be upfront with you. There's been no reported injuries or death from falling space debris. You're going to hear a lot about that with relation to Starlink, but that's never happened. So I'm just going to get that right out in front and make that disclosure. But as far as ASAT tests, yeah, they're spectacular from a psychological standpoint, in my opinion. But in the grand scheme of larger space debris, upper stages are really a much more bigger concern. The U.S. companies like ULA and SpaceX, they basically, you know, in most cases, defuel their upper stages and set them on a course where they're going to reenter within a reasonable amount of time. But the PRC and the Russians are a lot less prudent when it comes to disposing of their upper stages, and it's a big concern.
Why do they do that?
Because it would take either extra fuel or extra resources on their part to actually make sure that the upper stage basically reenters, doesn't become a hazard in the future.
Well, wouldn't that just be as dangerous for them as it is for anybody and make any future space operations more difficult?
But again, we're thinking like Westerners, and this is the issue I have with a lot of my colleagues who work for NGOs who are in academia, is they think the Chinese, the PRC should be just as concerned about these things as we are. But culturally, they're a lot different than we are. It's called mirror thinking, and it's a very bad thing to get into. A perfect example of this in the space weapon debate is, you've seen a lot of generals come up in the past few years and saying, in a space war, in a space war, nobody wins. Well, that isn't true. From the perspective of the PRC, there can be winners in this. In fact, even in nuclear war, back during the Cold War, the Soviets believed in some cases a nuclear war could be won, and that was the premise they operated on. Well, we operated on nobody wins, and that was our strategy. Thankfully, it worked. But again, we got to think. They have a different culture, and if you look back in their history, I mean, it's brutal as being nice to say, you know, their culture was, you know, violence, brutality was paramount in their culture. It was part of that, and they remember their history, so they don't think in terms of, you know, niceties of like, oh, we got to preserve the environment. I hate to say they don't care, but they're not as cognizant as the Western world is, because we have, you know, NGOs and we have laws, and we think we take into account the environment in terms of that. But again, in terms of them saying, well, you know, we, you know, a war, you know, nobody wins in a war. Well, it depends on how you define winning. And I believe they define winning differently than we do. In other words, you can win if winning is making the other guy, you know, not use the space assets.
Yeah. I remember Mao said, like, he didn't really care if China got struck by a nuclear weapon because, you know,
there's more people.
Yeah, like if a bunch of people die, yeah, you got more. And that's something the U.S. could not do.
Right.
And this gets into the idea of PLA version of deterrence is basically what we call preemption. In other words, I'm going to go on the offense, and I'm going to attack my adversary, and I'm going to basically hope for a big psychological impact, and then say, you know what, maybe it's not a good idea we escalate this further. Maybe you should just go aside. Let me share a scenario with you that I've given at other times about what happens in the lead up to a actual kinetic conflict between the U.S. and the PRC. Let's say Taiwan, because that's the big favorite right now. The PRC is getting ready to invade Taiwan, and they don't want the interference of the U.S. So they know that the U.S. is very reliant on their assets, including GPS, intelligence gathering satellites, communication satellites, what have you. PRC launches a couple of missiles, takes out a couple of satellites, and maybe jams a few others. And this sets the U.S. back on their heels. You know, U.S. commanders are basically, oh my God, we lost all these things. Now, people say, well, they won't do that because, you know, it's going to contain all the space debris and stuff like that. I say rubbish, because they're not worried about the space environment. They want the psychological impact. And nothing says psychological impact like actually smashing a satellite. That gets your attention. So basically afterwards, you know, if you degrade them enough, you can basically go to the U.S. and say, look, you know, maybe you shouldn't interfere with us, because it could get a lot worse for both sides. So let's just leave us alone. Let us do what we want to do. And everybody will be happy. No more deaths. I mean, That is actually their doctrine, and people don't understand that their version of, just like winning, their version of winning is different. Their version of deterrence is different as well.
So it's kind of like manipulating the idea of mutually assured destruction for their benefit. Like, okay, we don't want to get into, you know, we're both atomic powers. We don't want to have a nuclear war. Let's just, if things are already hot, just give us Taiwan and then we're done.
Do you want to get real scary?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Back in 2021, I believe it was, 2021, 2022, the Chinese tested what was called a fractional orbital bombardment system. Now, what happens with fractional orbital bombardment? The Soviets actually deployed this back during the Cold War. Is it actually, instead of just going up on a ballistic trajectory and then coming down, it actually gets into partially goes into orbit, but it doesn't complete a full orbit. But the idea is it skims along and not on a non-ballistic trajectory, and then drops its warhead out of orbit over the target at a very shallow angle. In the case of the Chinese vehicle that was tested, the actual vehicle was a hypersonic glide vehicle that could be armed with a nuclear warhead. Now, conventional missile defense we have is actually designed for ballistic, for incoming RVs that have a ballistic trajectory. In other words, very sharp, steep trajectory. They're not designed for a shallow trajectory where something can maneuver. So here's my scenario. The Chinese want to start some major actions. They want to keep the U.S. out of it completely, and basically they want to shape. They want to shock the political leadership, and basically they want to scare the population as well. Based on information they've received, they've acquired from, you know, balloon flights over U.S. ICBM fields, they do their targeting and select. Several targets from, say, the missile fields, a bomber base, what have you. Now, that would still leave the missile defense, you know, the missiles and the submarines undersea that they don't see. And they don't, but the idea is they want to stop the U.S. from retaliating from a strike. So what do? They launch these fractional orbital bombardment systems. They select missile fields. They take out the missile fields. They take out the bomber bases and basically neutralize land-based nuclear deterrent force. Then they go through their diplomatic channels, and they go directly to the White House, call directly to the White House, said, "Look, if you retaliated with your submarine launched missiles, we could really, you know, things could get really ugly, because then we'd have to retaliate with everything we have, and the Russians probably do it too, and we'd have nuclear holocaust. We don't want nuclear holocaust, and neither do you. So why don't we just stand out? Why don't you stand down from any retaliation, and we'll call it even?" Now, obviously, after, you know, multiple nuclear explosions on nuclear targets, the population is going to be scared. And with social media, the fear factor will be exponential. I mean, we're talking to the nth power type of influence. And you could actually, and the president might actually decide, and I'm not pointing to any particular president whatsoever, but the president might decide, you know what, instead of retaliating with the full force of our submarine ballistic missile capability, we're going to avoid further potential deaths in our cities. We're just going to basically back down. In other words, surrender.
Well, so what's the difference between that and like Pearl Harbor? Because Pearl Harbor actually galvanized the population and Congress to declare war when they originally were not going to.
I'm going to pin this on social media. I think because social media, the generation now is basically conditioned in a sense. I don't think we'd have that same sort of uprising or like 9/11, that same sort of, you know, unity, or say, we got to retaliate, especially when nuclear weapons are the big game changer. And something like that, where if the PRC limited their strikes to the missile fields, to the bomber bases, without, you know, really attacking the large population centers, I think public opinion would be so, the upswell of public opinion would be so great that, you know, the political leadership be forced to say, you know what, we got to not retaliate and basically let what the PRC do what they want to do. That's my ultimate scary scenario. It doesn't keep me up at night, but it does scare me every once in a while.
I mean, I guess what I'm wondering is if the CCP did this, or if they did, let's say, like your less scary scenario of like targeting some U.S. satellites and, you know, destroying them. I don't see how that wouldn't be considered like a direct attack on the U.S., right? So then Like, isn't that like possibly an overcalculation to think that they could take out a few satellites and then convince the U.S. to not help Taiwan?
The whole idea behind the three warfares is to shape, is to achieve a political objective. In other words, we want to create a situation where we can get the political leadership to do what we want to do without having to resort to kinetic force. If you can condition society through that. Well, let's put this for example. If you start whacking on top of military, on top of defense satellites like GPS, like reconnaissance and communication satellites, I start going after geosynchronous targets. The Chinese tested a system back a couple years ago where they actually went into geosynchronous orbit and went up to one of their dead Beta 1 Phase 1 satellites and actually grabbed onto it and flipped it out into a graveyard orbit. And we actually, and our space situational awareness capabilities actually watched this, saw this happening. Now, everybody was quiet for a while, but I looked at it and basically saying, I'll know a space weapon when I see it. That was a space weapon demonstration, in my opinion. That was an ASAT demonstration. What if they did that to a communication satellite? What if I'm watching the Super Bowl on cable TV and the PRC attacks a communication satellite that's actually broadcasting the Super Bowl? That's going to strike home. What if I swipe my credit card to get gas and I can't get through it because they interfered with one of my satellites? Now you're directly affecting the civilian population and not just the military aspect of the nation.
See, if they interrupted the Super Bowl, I think we would declare war on them.
Well, that all comes down to whether or not to declare war is a policy decision. That's got to come from the commander in chief.
I guess I wonder if this is how they see deterrence and are they seeing the U.S. clearly in, like, you talk about mirroring, right? Like the U.S. and what other Western countries assume that, like, the CCP would think the same as they would on certain issues. But I wonder if it could work in reverse to the detriment of the CCP as well, that, like, if they assume that, like, you know, if blasting a communication satellite during the Super Bowl would make people scared, but it actually makes people upset. Mm-hmm. Like the spy balloon thing, I think, it wasn't clear to the CCP or really to the Biden administration how upset, like, people would get over it.
Yeah,
right?
People weren't scared in America. They were just angry.
Exactly, because they violated our national airspace. There's this gentleman back many centuries ago named Sun Tzu, and he wrote this really nice little thing called The Art of War. It's about that thick. There's many translations out there. The James Clavell is the best, I think. Sun Tzu has this maxim. He was the ultimate guerrilla warfare. I mean, he was the ultimate guerrilla warfare. He basically codified it in The Art of War. But he says, three maxims: if you know the enemy, but you don't, if you don't know yourself, you're going to lose a lot of battles. If you know yourself but don't know your enemy, no, you're still going to lose a lot of battles. If you know the enemy and know yourself, you'll prevail every time. So the Chinese, they latch onto that and they study us. They study our greatest military tactician, who was Karl von Clausewitz. They actually study Clausewitz because that's a big foundation of what our military strategy and philosophy is based on, Clausewitz. So they study him. One of the greats who passed away was Andy Marshall. He was the head of the Office of Net Assessment for decades, and he was really awesome. And he understood this. He understood this that you've got to really, and in his later years, even after he retired from the Office of Net Assessment, he was really studying China. Beforehand, he was studying the Soviets. We got to understand the Soviets, and they never and. It was about clear. It was basically very, very murky understanding. And of course, the Soviets in the same state didn't really understand us as well. So this is why you have intelligence agencies. Not only seeing what they're up to, you're trying to understand them and understand what is motivating their decision making process.
Well, I think the question is then, if this is in these scenarios you've presented, obviously China hasn't done anything like that. Is there a reason why they haven't? Is it because they don't know how the U.S. will respond? Do they not have the technical capabilities?
It may be a little bit about everything, but I think bottom line is every time you do something in terms of a military action, it's a calculated risk. And the whole idea is their calculus is going to be, do the benefit, the potential success outweigh the obvious risk? In other words, if we try that limited strike, how do we know that, are we confident that we can convince them to back down and not retaliate with the rest of their nuclear forces? Or are they going to launch everything and level B Beijing and, you know, several billion people? And of course, the other thing is, can we depend on our quote allies, the Russians, to support us? Or are they going to see an opportunity while we're busy with the U.S. to come and attack us? So the game of geopolitics, especially between the Russians and the Chinese, is really fascinating. I mean, people are excited about, you know, the Russians and the Chinese working together, but I just tell everybody they're going to turn on each other eventually because they really can't stand each other and they don't trust each other. It's going to happen eventually.
Yeah, that relationship is already very fraught. China's been making a lot of inroads into all the Stan countries, Russia's dismay.
But as long as Xi Jinping and Putin still have ice cream, you know.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Right. They are best friends.
Well, but I mean, what happens when you have two authoritarian regimes is that there's naturally a lack of trust in authoritarianism, right? Which is why you have authoritarianism. It's the cause of and result of a very low trust situation. And so you have these two countries in very low trust situations. They are not going to trust each other. I mean, I think that this is, you know, to your point, they're fundamentally can't be this, what the US has, for example, with the UK, right? There's a high trust there.
I don't trust them.
Okay. Well, there we go.
Yeah. But I mean, you can have ice cream with each other, but I remind all after President Trump's had a diplomatic dinner at the White House with Xi Jinping, just as they were eating chocolate cake, cruise missiles were bombing a Syrian airfield going after chemical weapons, which he actually mentioned to the premier while he was eating his chocolate cake. So the art of statecraft is one that's been practiced for thousands and thousands of years. And it is, when you're shaking hands, you're basically holding a club, but you should be holding a club on the other side to make sure that the other side knows that you're not going to turn your back on them. So it's a very delicate thing. I mean, there's a maxim. I'm not sure exactly who quoted it, but it says nations don't have allies or friends. They have interests. And that's what the world is based on. It's based on state interest. And this whole idea of, you know, we can be one big happy family. Well, I hate that maxim to begin with because, you know, having done domestic law, I can tell you families can get really, really nasty in some cases. But the whole idea is states have interest. And if they do something, it's not because they're going to be nice about it. It's because it's in their interest to do it at that time.
Well, so then I guess the obvious question then is what should the U.S. be doing? Is the Space Force doing anything?
If whatever they're doing is probably classified special access project, that's way above my pay grade and I don't need to know. And unless, you know, they decide I need to know, and hence I wouldn't be able to talk to you about it anyways. I don't know. But again, there's issues of, you know, that gets into domestic politics. How much do we want to fund them? Do we want to take this next step of getting away from this idea of we can take a gut punch and we'll just keep on taking gut punches and discourage them because we're taking gut punches, or actually have a capability to punch back hard? I mean, and the whole idea of developing an ASAT is a very, very touchy issue. Back when the air launch ASAT was tested during the Reagan administration, there was an actual program, and Reagan wanted to make this into an actually deployed force, have a wing of F-15s that were just dedicated to launching ASATs. But Congress shut him down. They threw basically, we're not going to give you the money for it, which basically shut down the program. And Reagan was very, very upset about that. In fact, he had this nice long speech that you can actually find in the Reagan archives that basically goes through and said he was very displeased with Congress's decision to cancel the program. Since then, we have not had an actual active ASAP program that we've admitted to. Now, again, the world of special access, you know, is a black world where a lot of money goes into and is behind a lot of walls. So we don't really know what kind of offensive capabilities the U.S. does have. We may have what we call a breakout capability that we won't reveal unless there is actually a hostility that demands that we have to use it.
Well, so since like a lot of what you're talking that China is doing with this type of space warfare is actually essentially psychological lawfare, these kinds of things, what can the U.S. do about those things that the CCP is doing?
Well, we have the most lawyers per capita as any country in the world. We got to start using them, and we got to start understand. We got to get away from this idea of purely kinetic warfare and understand that we're actually at war right now. As far as PRC is concerned, we're at war, but we're in a hybrid warfare, and they're using the three and four warfares very effectively. I actually recommended in an article that I wrote last year, and I can send a link after we're done, for actually to form this group called the Special Legal Warfare Tiger Team. And basically the idea is you gather legal professionals around, a group of legal professionals who will basically come generate policy solutions to world events and transmit that up for consideration to the president, the State Department, what have you. Let me give you an example. Back in November 2021, the Russian Federation used a ancillary capability to missile defense to intercept and destroy one of their old satellites. And it caused a huge fracas. And all of a sudden, here everybody said, oh, this is a Russian ASAT test. And the problem is we got caught in this idea of test, because in the Outer Space Treaty, testing a weapon, there's nothing that forbids it. So even the Office of Secretary of Defense was looking at this. What legal recourse do we have here? And they didn't, because the problem was they got caught in this narrative that it's a test. So I came out, I have a briefing letter, and I actually wrote an issue of my briefing letter for this. But basically my idea was, look, come back, instead of calling it a test, call it a demonstration of a weapon system. What's the difference between a test and a weapon system? A test basically is, I'm doing this to see if I can do it. A demonstration is saying, this is what I can do. And actually, a couple of days after that demonstration, and I call it a demonstration, they came out in the media saying, now we can effectively target U.S. GPS satellites and knock out, you know, at least a couple dozen of them. And this was just prior to the Ukraine invasion. So bottom line is, my theory was, this Special Legal Warfare Tiger Team, if they need to come up with a narrative, they could say, instead of calling it a test, call it a demonstration. What happens then? Well, if you call it a demonstration, that's, in my opinion, a technical violation of the Outer Space Treaty. In other words, the Outer Space Treaty is couched in this idea of non-aggressive, peaceful uses of outer space. And demonstrating a weapon that smashes a satellite, even if it's your own, is definitely not peaceful. So what could you do then? Well, you could blow it up in the media. You could blow up in speeches. You could instruct the U.S. ambassador to the UN to go to the Security Council and lodge a formal protest that the Russian Federation made a technical violation of the Outer Space Treaty through this demonstration. In other words, it wouldn't do anything significant in terms of deterring them, but it would definitely embarrass them on the political stage and definitely knock them back. That would be lawfare in use. But unfortunately, we got into this thing called, it was a test, and it just basically locked us up in the Outer Space Treaty because the Outer Space Treaty doesn't do it. But again, we don't think like that, and we got to start thinking like that. We got to start thinking more flexibly, and this Special Legal Warfare Tiger Team that I proposed would be an excellent way to start it.
Well, I don't know. Are we sure we really want to anger China? We need to work with them on climate change.
Well, this is the problem. You know, we're so stuck on, well, we got to keep talking. And I think my proposal is, look, talk is cheap. Talk, but come from a position of strength and not a weakness. Because whenever we say we want to talk, they love it. Back in 2018, we're going to go back to space weapons a little bit. The U.S. went to the UN Convention on Disarmament in Geneva, and they basically shut down the whole space weapon debate. I mean, they destroyed it, burnt it to ashes, because they came out and said, look, you talk about space weapons, how the U.S. is this bad guy. Look at everything you're doing with all these counter space technology you're developing and demonstrating in orbit. You have no legal, political, or moral right to even talk to about it. They completely burned it down. And for several years after, they tried to revive it with no success. However, the new administration came in and the UK decided, well, we're going to go back to the old tried and true method of diplomacy again. And we did this thing called the Open-End Working Group for space security. The UK led it. The US was there propping it up and supporting it. And the Russians and the Chinese didn't like it, but they signed and said, okay, we'll we'll play along. And basically, they used it to revive the whole space weapon debate. And at the end of the open-ended working group, they basically, this draft report they generated, they voted against it and basically destroyed it. So fundamentally, the U.S., the U.K. and the U.S., by going back to the tried and true member, we got to talk. They gave them an opportunity to actually revive the whole space weapon thing right from basically what were just ashes and basically start pummeling us with it again.
Well, definitely when you were talking about the whole mirror thinking thing, I definitely thought about the climate change issue because, like, of course they should care about climate change too. It affects everyone.
Again, talk is cheap. Don't with the Chinese, with the PRC, ignore what they say, watch what they do.
That's very good advice.
If you look at how the Chinese Communist Party treats its, you know, water, soil, air, oceans in terms of pollution, right? There's no reason to believe that if they clearly are not particularly concerned about the pollution impact in China on its own people, there's no reason to believe they're going to be concerned about space pollution or really about, you know, nuclear destruction or any of these things.
Well, look at this way. Fundamentally, what the PRC and the Russian Federation want to do, and they basically said this a couple of years ago, they want to change the whole international world order. They're all for the rule of law, but they want it to be their rules. That is the underlying motivation. That's why it's important to get back to the moon. That's why it's important not to underestimate. I want to be clear. I'm not a China hater. I don't hate anybody. The only thing I hate is when I compare outer space to the Earth. I hate that.
But you did a great job doing that with the South China Sea. I think that made it really intelligible. So it's nice that you really sunk into what you hate the most.
But I still hate it. I don't get up in the mirror and saying those damn Chinese, you know, they're the lowest form of life. I don't. They have their state. I understand. They are a state and they have their interests. I don't agree with their interests. And the U.S., but the U.S. has its interests as well. I respect them for the simple fact is they will look at every angle and they're not afraid to take action on that angle instead of just, you know, wringing their hands. Well, what if we offend somebody? I can guarantee you, I tell people, look, you know, if you're going to ask me a question, be careful because you may not like the answer because I'm going to be honest with them about it. I offend people all the time. I'm not very popular in this field because I am very straightforward with it. I don't get into political narratives or platitudes. I'm very blunt and to the point. And I'm that way in my law practice too. So, but I respect them for the fact that they have state interests. I respect them for the fact that they are they're proactive and they're not afraid to try something. They're very assertive. That aside, I love being an American. My father was an immigrant from Austria, and I'm first generation. I love my country, and you know, I try to help my country, you know, by promoting these ideas, about national security and national defense. And again, it's not this whole thing that, you know, I hate China, I hate Russia.
I mean, I guess I feel like the fact that you even have to come out with this big disclaimer about how you don't hate China or Chinese people is a demonstration of the success of their political warfare, precisely. Right? That they can use precisely. That to attack people.
Well, basically the whole NGOs in outer space security right now, it's about we're one world, we got to come together, we got to preserve space for the common good. That's rubbish. And the Chinese feed on that rubbish. You feed on that very nicely. It's a simple matter of we have state interest, we have our way of life, and we want to preserve that way of life. And we got to make sure our interests in space are met, while at the same time while making sure that the PRC, the Russian Federation, what have you, their interests aren't conflicting or basically trying to overwrite our interests. Again, it's all about state interests. That's how the world runs.
So if our viewers or listeners wanted to hear more of your thoughts, where should they go?
Well, you can follow me on LinkedIn. I have a website, www.spacelawsolutions.com. I have a briefing letter called The Pressy that I put out quarterly that you can subscribe to. Yes, unfortunately, it is a paid subscription, but I put a lot of work into it. But that gives you my insights that I don't publish anywhere else. I am, if you Google, if you put my name in a search engine, you'll come up with a lot of my papers. I do have a YouTube channel called Space Thoughts, which I'm probably going to start getting back into in the next month or so, that where I just basically lay out, I basically call it like I see it. And it might offend you. So you might have, you know, you should be forewarned that might offend you with my ideas or my thoughts on things. But those are the best ways to do it. Again, if you're free to try and connect with me on LinkedIn, if you like, of course, I have the discretion of whether or not I will accept a connection, because I am very careful about who I actually connect with on social media.
Well, I hope everyone watching will at least subscribe to the YouTube channel, give you a little boost there. But yeah, it's been a pleasure having you on.
Thank you for having me.
I think it's really interesting, his whole thing about mirror thinking. Like, that's definitely, it's so easy to fall in that trap of, oh, like, you know, everyone thinks like me.
Yeah, I do think that is like a very human thing to do.
Yeah.
Is to like not be able to look outside yourself and be like, huh, do other people treat this differently maybe?
Yeah. And so that is a real problem. I mean, like, I think the great example is Mao and nuclear warfare. Like, if the U.S. lost 500,000 people in a nuclear war, that would be devastating.
I mean, there aren't 500.
I know, it would be especially devastating.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think it's just easy, though, in the Mao example, to be like, oh, well, like, Mao was crazy dictator, right? You know, and not to understand that, like, actually this entire, like, the entire communist system is built on thinking like this. It's not just like Mao was one individual crazy leader who, the megalomaniac kind of person.
Yeah, right? He established a system where the people who think in that sort of sadistic, sociopathic way can much more easily rise to the top. And that's why we've seen every leader since Mao also be involved in one or more extremely brutal acts of murder, torture, and so on, right? Like, that's just the whole thing. You can't escape that.
You almost make the CCP sound like some kind of frat where, like, the hazing ritual is to go commit, like, a small genocide, you know, like, just right, against like the Tibetans.
The Tibetans, right? And then this little genocide, and then he gets promoted, and he's chairman, and then now he can commit further genocide. Yeah, it is actually a good example. It's like a frat, but, you know, worse.
What were you saying earlier about it would be good if we didn't go off the rails at the end?
Yeah. I had a thought, and then I was watching us go off the rails, and then the thought got left behind.
I'm sorry. I think that was my fault for the frat thing, but I do think it's an interesting analogy.
Yeah, and I mean, you do see that with, you know, the climate stuff. Like, obviously, the Chinese Communist Party does not care about climate change. And if we keep approaching, if we have to work with China, I remember what I was going to say. It's the whole problem with this end of history nonsense that has really dominated the Western thinking.
Yeah, well, so I feel like it's starting to come away from that. I think there's, you know, I think it started like actually being codified into policy under the Trump administration, where they had a paper on China, a strategic paper that came out and said, look, this is about great power competition. Mm-hmm. Like, this is, and that is like a different worldview than the idea of, like, you know, global cooperation, this kind of UN, like, world peace.
We're just all going to work together for economic benefit.
That we kind of like grew up learning about, right?
Yeah. Well, I think that was a big issue in the Trump administration with, for example, NATO, like Trump demanding NATO allies pay their fair share for the military. And like, especially Germany really resented that idea because it's the end of history. We don't need to have these military.
Kind of ironic that it was Germany, actually.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But
I mean, they should have already realized that didn't make sense after Putin invaded Crimea. But like, obviously now with the Ukraine war, I think that people are kind of realizing that, like, wait, maybe we aren't all just going to work together for economic prosperity.
But I think the problem is that you have all these people in, like, for example, in the Foreign Service in the U.S. or in the State Department or these places where they have grown up learning about the end of history or this kind of, you know, philosophy. So now to kind of be like, all right, actually it is about state interest and power competition and all this stuff.
Yeah, it was interesting that Michael used the example of, like, in his terror scenario, that it began with, like, the spy balloon figuring out where these locations are.
Mm-hmm.
because like the Biden administration tried to cover it up. Like that's come out now. Like they didn't want that getting public because it was like, oh, why is this a big deal?
Well, I mean, also they wanted to
talk to China.
Yeah. I mean, Blinken was supposed to go to China, so.
Yeah. They didn't want to interfere with that. And that's still kind of this whole like, you know, well, we got to do diplomacy. We got to talk. Talking is the most important thing. But if you look at it outside of the lens of this end of history thing and realize like, oh, this is actual strategic information they're getting. This could be used for very nefarious things. We shouldn't just try to cover it up.
I think also things like you brought up climate change. I think this is a case in which the CCP was really able to manipulate John Kerry in particular by, you know, he had this relationship with the Chinese climate negotiator that had been going on for over a decade. And then after John Kerry like left the State Department, right, and then when he came back as the Biden administration's like climate czar, the CCP pulled that same guy out of retirement to talk to John Kerry again. So it's kind of like understanding this idea of personal relationships and the idea that it may be more, Kerry might feel more amenable if he's dealing with the same guy.
We're just all people.
You know, who's been talking to him for so long and they feel like, they get along and they can, you know, even if their governments are not, you know, like on a personal level, you know.
Yeah, it's amazing. Like the Chinese Communist Party really understands the story that we tell ourselves. And then is manipulating that pretty well. I don't know why they know us so well, but we don't know them. I guess we know them. Well, do they know us?
Do they know us?
Do they know me?
Does it know you? Oh, God, this is getting deep.
Well, I do think that, I mean, that's what we've been trying to do for a decade now, right?
Yeah.
Is getting people to understand the CCP. But I think I don't know. I mean, I think there's a bunch of psychological things that go into why we don't understand them as well as they understand us. And I think some of it is the political warfare directly done by the CCP in the form of trying to make themselves look like us to us. Right. Do you know what I mean?
Well, I think also the majority of people on the planet, I believe, want peace, right? And there's a much smaller minority of people who want war and aggressive action. But it's so easy for a small number of aggressive people to start conflict because anyone can start conflict. It's much harder to maintain peace. And often peace needs to be maintained through a type of strength, right? Whether it's military or other strength. And I think that's kind of the disconnect. So the point I'm making is that it's very hard for people who want to live in a sort of kumbaya world, and I do, to understand how just lopsided is, how really the small number of people really don't care at all about that and they want to dominate. And those people have risen to the top.
I feel like the problem with your analogy is that it's like the thing that's happening is that essentially the CCP can do things like weaponize the use of the idea of peace, right?
Right.
And so, yeah, anyway. I don't know where I was going with
that. Which is actually the point that I was attempting to make but did not.
Well, I think even the idea that, oh, you know, most people want peace, that's even like an assumption that I don't think existed at a certain point in history. Like, you know, Caesar became a hero after he murdered a million Gaul and enslaved a million more. And that wasn't just like, you know, him. That was everyone like, hey, this guy, he's beloved of the gods. So I don't even know if like this whole peace thing, like I don't think that's like a fundamental, just it naturally exists amongst humanity.
Don't worry, we've channeled all that aggression into professional sports in the US.
So if we get rid of the sports, if China knocks out the Super Bowl, then all that contained lust for blood will be unleashed.
Yeah, so that would be a very serious miscalculation.
The most serious of all.
I did not know where that was going to go, but yeah, you kind of brought it back.
I brought it back. Before we get more off the rails, I think this is a good time to end.
I was going to suggest, Chris, that you might want to like go to, since Michael compared the South China Sea to the moon and outer space, that maybe it's time to go plant the China Uncensored flag on the moon.
Oh, yeah, I was thinking of that. I did plant my flag on the Scarborough Shoal, and that was a territorial claim.
Okay, that wasn't just, you know, pride in our show,
no,
making it
no,
to the South China Sea.
I own the Scarborough Shoal.
I feel like our Filipino audience is going to have something to say about that.
You should be happy. It's not China.
Yeah, you're protecting it from China.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you for watching China Unscripted. I'm Chris Chappell.
I'm Shelley Zhang.
And I'm Matt Ganesta.
We'll talk to you next time. Keep an eye out for our flag. Who knows where we'll turn up.